want to explain something to you, Gump. I got in trouble when I introduced my wife when I was named as Barack's running mate, and I said, you're about to meet my wife and she's drop-dead gorgeous. Well, and I also pointed out she's brilliant. The fact of the matter is, I love your team, but my wife's from Philly. My wife is the most rabid, and you know how Philly fans are. So I will wear this proudly as long as she's not around, because if I do, I'll be sleeping alone. You can take it back now and hold it, but I want it back. Hey, Gump, thanks a lot for being here, and Tommy, thank you, Mr. Mayor, thank you. You have a major scholarship dinner you put on, or event you put on, so go. Go, get out of here. I want to also start off by thanking Rob Baker, the New England Steering Committee Chair, Tom Lesser, Ben Schwartz, Noah Shaw, for putting this on. I appreciate your great team. Folks, it's great to be back in Boston. It's great to be at Fenway Park. As a matter of fact, I was saying to Larry Rasky, the Phillies could probably win tonight. Boston's not here. Let me begin by thanking all of you for the hard work you did for us, for Barack, individually as a nominee, and then jointly when we were running together as a team. Not only what you got, we know we wouldn't be in the White House without all of you assembled here today. And we also know that you believed in what we've been saying. You figured out a long time ago when we said we're looking for change, that we're not looking for change in the margins. We mean it. We mean real change. The governor has it right. The governor, this is a moment. And the president and I, as I said, would not be occupying the White House or West Wing without your continued help. And we would, we're determined. We're determined to bring the change we promised we would bring to this country. You know, I think it's fair to say that no president, and I got recognized 29 years old in the United States Senate. I have served with 8 presidents of the United States. I can say without fear and contradiction, no president in my lifetime, and I would argue no president in the lifetime of anyone in this state, has had as much laid on his plate the first day taking office as the president of the United States has. And ladies and gentlemen, it's our responsibility. But the bottom line here is simple, that every single solitary issue that's laid before us requires us to do something.
Excuse me, sir.
Because if we fail to act, it's a decision. Remember when President Clinton got in trouble at the front end of the campaign of his presidency by saying he was trying to do too much at one time? And he said, why don't you prioritize things like Reagan did, list 1, 2, 3, and put things aside? Can anyone name me a problem we face at this moment that we have the luxury of being able to say, we're not going to attend to it now, we're going to put it over here, and we'll attend to it in a year or 2 or 4 years? That, if we were to do it, is in and of itself a fundamental decision. A fundamental decision, because change is occurring. Non-action will bring significant change, but not positive change. You know, it's that when you were back in high school and you took physics, you learned about a deflection point. That's that point, kind of picture, you're in an automobile, your hands are in a steering wheel, you're going dead straight, and you turn the wheel slightly, and the car goes careening off another direction, not able to be corrected and brought back on course in an instant. Well, we're at one of those inflection points in American history. It hasn't occurred 5 times in all of our history, in my view. And ladies and gentlemen, non-action is action. The reason I mention this is I would argue that no administration has moved as fast to deal with the problems on its plate as this administration has. As the president says, even our critics agree, we've been pretty busy the last 128 days, or 25 days. You know, let's take a look at what's happened in the first 125 days, what we've been able to do with the help of the Democratic Congress. the Ledbetter Fair Pay Act. We've been fighting for fair pay for women for the last 3 years. To give you a wage for foundation workers. Children's health insurance. We insured 11 million more children than the rest of the world to have before. And a series of decisive steps to deal with the worst economic crisis any president has inherited since the Great Depression. The president organized and coordinated a worldwide response. Remember prior to the meeting of the G20, when they said this can't be done? Well, not everybody, since he got it done, was acting like, well, of course it can get done. But the truth of the matter was, it's never happened before to get the major economies on the same page in a worldwide recession. We've worked to stabilize the financial system, to get credit flowing again. It's slow, but it's beginning. It's beginning to flow as banks begin to regain their footing. We've moved to breathe life back into the housing market. There's a lot of foreclosures, many too many foreclosures to continue. But there's also new home buying, there's new home building. It's slow, but it's beginning. You know, I saw today, front page of USA Today, Americans more optimistic than they were 100 days ago. Just a month ago, 40% of the people said, we think we're moving in the right direction. It's 48% now. That's not sufficient, but it's moving. It's moved. We've set a policy withdrawal for American forces from Iraq, which we will complete. We will get it done.